If we don't, those of us who know them need to be telling somebody. Well, this morning, in the message, Brother Ben walked down the middle aisle and started asking people who you know Jesus as. And he got down there and I thought, surely he's not going to call on the preacher. He wouldn't do that to me in front of everybody. He didn't. What he didn't tell me is the rest of the message he got me with. So that was kind of sneaky, I thought, but hey, whatever works, you know. Tonight, take your Bibles, turn to the book of 1 John, chapter 4. 1 John, chapter 4. You know, I'm not exactly sure what year that song came out that Sister Betty was just sang. It was either in the late 70s or early 80s. I can't remember exactly. I think the cathedrals made it popular back in the day. And it was just prior to Brother Danny coming. But that song has been an encouragement to a lot of people. And did you hear the line in there? It says, some call him Savior. Yeah, so Brother Ben was asking us this morning, wasn't it? Do we know him as Savior? You know, that's absolutely essential. That's absolutely important. Tonight, as we look in the book of 1 John, I'm going to tell you what. I know that 1 Corinthians chapter 13 is considered the love chapter, even though the word love in four letters is not found there. It's charity, right? But tell me, I'm going to tell you that nobody writes as much about love as John does. John was called the beloved disciple, and he really loved Jesus. I really believe that. I believe all the disciples, minus one, really loved Jesus. I believe that they really cared for him, and he obviously loved them incredibly. But when we talk about love, the world has such a distorted, twisted view of what love is. Love, oftentimes, people think love means tolerance. It does not mean tolerance. You know, you can say what you want, and you say, well, does love tolerate? Well, the Bible says charity bears all things. Yeah, love does bear. Love does, but when it comes to tolerance, it doesn't mean that you just forget about whatever the situation is and not worry about it anymore. If love meant tolerance, then we'd all be on our way to hell. Yep. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Right? So if love meant tolerance, God would go, well, they're all sinners. Hey, what are you going to do? I'll just say, that's okay. I love you. No, he wouldn't have really loved us if he hadn't provided a way for us. So when we look here at this passage of Scripture, the title of the message tonight is The Love of God Is. The Love of God Is. We're going to look at three things, beginning in verse 7. 1 John chapter 4, verse 7, we're going to go through verse 21. So if you're there with me, say amen. Amen. All right. So at least I know 85% of you are awake, right? So, all right. So as we look here in verse 7, it says, Beloved, let us, by the way, let me just tell you straight up, you're going to hear the word love so many times here. If you don't get that this is about love, then maybe you're one of those that are taking a nap, okay? I just wanted to tell you, you're going to hear about love. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. In this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us. See, we didn't set the standard for love. God did, okay? And it says, herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. No man hath seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and his love is perfected in us. Hereby know we that we dwell in him, and he in us, because he hath given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. There's that word again, okay? Savior. Whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwelleth in him, and he in God. And we have known and believe the love that God hath to us. God is love, and that he dwelleth in love, dwelleth in God, and God in him. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. We love him, because he first loved us. If a man say, I love God, and hateth his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother, whom he hath seen, how can he love God, whom he hath not seen? And this is the commandment, or this commandment have we from him, that he who loveth God love his brother also. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, help us to see clearly the message tonight. God, it's often said love is what makes the world go round, but it is not the brand of love that's being peddled by the world. It is the love that you have shown us, that you have shown us by the giving freely of your Son, Jesus Christ, for our sins. God, we thank you for loving us. Lord, we certainly don't deserve it, but Lord, I'm grateful that you chose to send Jesus for a wretch like me. God, we ask your forgiveness of our sin. We do love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So there's a few things that I want us to see tonight here, and we're kind of going to jump around this chapter a little bit because the chapter deals with certain subjects in it, and it doesn't just finish with one. It'll pick up back with it during the course of the chapter. But the first thing is that the love of God is the evidence of our relationship. Okay? It's the evidence of our relationship. I'm here to say that if we don't love one another, we don't love God. Does anybody remember that old bluegrass song? If you don't love your neighbor, then you don't love God. I wonder where they got that from, huh? If you don't love your neighbor, then you don't love God. Well, the evidence of our relationship we see here beginning in verse 7 says, Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. Okay? So there's an evidence. Sometimes people say, how can you know God is real? Okay? And again, there's a lot of songs that run through my head. I've listened to a lot of songs down through the... Is anybody else like this? You know a lot of songs, and you know like about a third of words to all the songs, but rarely do you know all of them to any of the songs? Yeah, you can be, oh, it goes like this, and you're singing a few words. Of course, you don't do that with Amazing Grace, but you can say, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound, and you know how the rest of it goes, right? You know, you think of that sometimes. But when you think about stuff like this, when it comes to love, there's so many songs out there about love, and there are love songs, okay? But the love that we're talking about tonight is a love that gave up everything for what the object of love was about, okay? Jesus Christ gave himself freely and completely on the cross of Calvary. So we need to understand that in order for us to reciprocate that love, we have to give the same kind of love back. Okay? We don't give a cheaper form of love. You know, you ever heard that saying, well, I can love them, but I don't have to like them. That's a cheap form of love right there, let me tell you. Okay? That's a cheap form of love. Okay? When we look at this passage of Scripture, we see here that God makes it clear that for love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knows God. We know God because we feel his love within us. The moment that you got saved, you know, we hear the Bible say that, behold, old things have passed away, behold, all things have become new. You become a new creature. We've heard that down through the years. But when we stop and think about it, folks, at the moment we got saved, something happened there. Something changed. We went from a place of realizing that we were in absolute and total despair and that we didn't deserve anything, but somehow or another, the Almighty God of heaven loved us enough to send his Son for us. And it touched our hearts and it broke our hearts, and we realized at that point all we had to do was put faith in that promise, and then, bam, God put his love on us. He put it on us. at that moment. Why? Because when he saved you, he did that because he loved you. Okay? And that doesn't mean that he doesn't love everybody else. It's just that faith allows God to show us completely how much he loves us. Okay? That we get to experience that. So, for the scientifically minded, say, how can that just because what you feel or what you, well, we have scripture that tells us, but we can also feel, you know. Well, somebody will say, what if our brain, you know, what if we just evolved? What do we, how can anything spiritual be contained in something physical? And in all this kind of stuff. Well, first of all, where do emotions and things like that come from? You know, could you imagine if we honestly believed that we evolved from some kind of an amoeba that come out of a mud puddle somewhere? How in the world can we even trust our own thoughts and our own feelings? You say, well, you're not supposed to trust them. You're supposed to put them, that faith in God, but you have to admit, you have to act on those feelings. And you have to act on those emotions, okay? I heard a preacher say one time, I wouldn't give you a dime for something you couldn't feel. The love of God is felt, just like the love for one another is felt, okay? Something truly, genuinely happens when we trust Jesus Christ as our Savior. We feel the love of God and know that it's there because it changes us. You know, I won't tell you who it is, but there's a man in our midst that told me one time it was the love of God that changed him because the person that he was before, nobody wanted to be around. Nobody wanted to be around. Wanted anything at all to do with them because that's just how they were. But now this person wants to be around other people and other people want to be around them. So we see a definite change takes place. So first of all, we see that we are spiritually related to God when it comes to our relationship with him. It says here in verse 8, he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. And this was manifested, the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. So we are spiritually related to him. If we go back to John chapter 3, which we know where John 3:16 is, but just a few verses before that, the Bible tells us in John chapter 3, verses 3 through 5, that we are born again from above, okay? There's that transaction that takes place at the moment we put faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And the reason that we have that is because God loves us. We become children of God. John says in John chapter 1, verse 11 or 12, that unto him he gave them power to become the sons of God, okay? Because he loves us. So we are spiritually related to God. You know, if you ever, you know, sometimes, I realize we all have relatives that sometimes are kind of hard to love, but have you ever noticed that you've got relatives that somehow you love just because they're your relatives? Has anybody got any of those? You just know that they're kin to you, and you love them, okay? You may not had a constant contact with them, but just by virtue. You know, I've got a cousin that I've seen 6 times in my life, and never for any more than just a few hours. But when I see her, immediately, I know that I love her, just because of who she is, you know? Just because of the fact that she's my cousin. I've got one uncle left. He's a great uncle on my dad's side. Okay, I have no, I don't know if you, you don't want to call them not so great uncles. Your uncles, regular uncles, whatever. I don't have any more of those left on my dad's side of the family. And I wish my two uncles were watching tonight on my mom's side of the family. Because for all intents and purposes, they're not around either, but I still love them. So there's something about being related to somebody that's a blessing and that you love them because of that. So we're spiritually related. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. We become the children of God at the moment we trust in Jesus Christ, because God loves his children. As we move on, we also are intimately related with God. It says, he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. Okay? Verse 7 also says, everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. Okay? So there's more than just kind of an understanding that's who that is, but you also know who he is. He is someone that you know things about, you know attributes about them, you know likes and dislikes. Of course, we know God loves us so much, he knows everything about us and loves us anyway. You ever stop and think about that? What reason have I given God today to love me? And then you stop and think, I'm glad I don't have to give him one, because he loves me anyway. That doesn't give me a free pass, but the fact of the matter is that there's nothing that I've ever done that would make God love me. Okay? He loves me anyway. But the Bible tells us here in this passage in the book of 1 John chapter 4 that if there's no God, there's no love, and vice versa. It just doesn't happen. As we move on in this particular passage of Scripture, we see in verse 9, in this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Where do you think John might have heard that? Okay? We see here that it's very similar to John chapter 3 and verse 16. Herein is love, verse 10, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. I got to stop right here and tell Sister Melissa something. Tommy Brown corrected a whole class on the word of propitiation one day. You don't say propitiation. He says it's propitiation. Okay? He's in Arkansas. What do I care? I'm going to say it how I want. But the fact of the matter is that he gave his Son for us to be an atonement or a covering for our sins. Okay? That's love. Let me share with you. You probably heard the story before we move on to the next point. There's a story of a man who heard a bump in the night. And he got up out of his bed and ran into the next room where his young son was asleep. And he flipped the light on, and as he flipped the light on, he noticed a pool of blood in the bed where his son lay. All simultaneously, he saw a person go out the window. So in his effort to take care of the situation, he pursued after the murderer. He went out the window, pursued after the murderer, and caught him. And held him. And he says, what are you going to do to me now? He says, I'll tell you what. You killed my son. But if you'll accept my offer, I'll take you into my house and make you as my son. But if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. Again, where has he heard this? Jesus taught them that if you have love one for another, by this shall all men know you that are my disciples. He says, I've written a new commandment unto you. He says, that you love one another as I have loved you. Okay? Which one of us would do what I just said? He said it'd be pretty tough, right? Well, isn't that a cheaper kind of love than what God has offered us? Sometimes, folks, we have to stop and think, and we have to challenge ourselves, and I know I do. Sometimes I get judgmental with people. I'll look at them and go, boy, I don't know if there's any hope for that person. But listen, Jesus Christ tasted death for every man. And he died for them just like he died for me. And he wants to save them just like he wanted to save me. I have no business sorting out who should get saved and who. I have no business sorting out who gets to hear the gospel message and who doesn't. It's just my job to tell the world about Jesus Christ. No man hath seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and his love is perfected in us. Guess what? I think I heard a statement earlier today about sometimes we talk about people's outward appearance, and what we need to be concerned about is their inward state. And once they get their inward state taken care of, then it will start to work outward. How do you think we're doing with that? Just asking. Start with yourself. Then once you figure out how you're doing with that, then maybe you can think about some other people and how they're doing with that and trying to encourage them too. Okay? Do I live like the God of all heaven lives within me? Okay? It says right here that he dwelleth in us. He's right here. Okay? He's right here every moment, 24/7, constantly. But if we love one another, we have an evidence that God dwells in us and his love is perfected in us. Can you imagine, first of all, God, who is perfect and who is love, that he would choose to perfect his love in us, which are imperfect? Okay? That should absolutely blow our minds. I want you to look down to verses 20 and 21 real quick, and then we'll jump back up. Verses 20 and 21 say this: if a man say, I love God, and hateth his brother, he is a liar. You say, that sounds pretty strong, preacher. Yeah, that's the Bible for you. For he that loveth not his brother whom he hath seen, how can he love God whom he hath not seen? Okay? We need to be reminded of this, folks. Our relationship with God is directly tied to our relationship with one another. It is directly tied to it. You cannot sever that relationship. And it says, in this commandment have we from him, that he who loveth God love his brother also. Again, are we loving one another with the same love that God is loving us? If we're not, then we're sharing a cheap form of love. Cheap form of love. So we have the evidence of our relationship, now the essence of our redemption. Back up to verse 13. As we look here, it says, hereby know we that we dwell in him, and he in us, because he hath given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father sent the Son into the world, or to be the Savior of the world. Whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwelleth in him, and he in God. And we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love, and then he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. So he has given us of his Spirit. Folks, this is not just some kind of random ritual thing that takes place. It's not something that we're doing because we're trying to work our way to heaven, as Brother Ben mentioned this morning. We're not working to get anywhere. It's the Spirit of God. It's the earnest of his Spirit that seals us till the day of redemption. It's the indwelling of God by his Holy Spirit that sheds the love of God abroad in our hearts. It says here, and we have seen and do testify. Let me ask you this question. I'm going to chop this up in half real quick. Have we seen God working in our lives? Now, you ready for this one? Do we testify? John says, we have seen and do testify. Yeah, he says, I was there. I saw him. I touched him. I laid on his breast. I followed him. Everywhere he was, nearly for 3.5 years, I was there. Now I'm here to tell you about him. Well, guess what? Since you know Jesus Christ, your Savior, everywhere you are, he's there also. And we should be telling people about him everywhere we go. Everywhere we go. Okay? And it says, Whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwelleth in him, and he in God. I'm going to tell you, this word is not just a verbal confession. This is not, yeah, I believe that Jesus is who he says he is. No, this is an absolute, convinced, absolutely, what's the word I'm looking for? Sold out understanding that Jesus is who he says he is, and that we have trusted in him, and we know that he loves us by the fact that he sent his only begotten son. This is an absolute. This is not just some random, you know, I tell you all the time, sometimes you watch sports figures. We haven't watched many here lately. You watch sports figures, they hit a home run or they get a touchdown, they'll, you know, cross themselves or they'll do whatever and they'll point to the sky. I would love to think that they're talking about the same God that we're talking about and not just the guy that's working on the light tower or some figment of somebody's imagination in the realm of religion. But whoever shall confess, that means wholeheartedly, absolutely convinced that Jesus is who he says he is, God dwelleth in him, and he in God. It says, when we have known and believed the love that God hath to us, God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and he in him. Yet, have you noticed like another recurring theme? This is at least the third time we've seen that God dwells in us. How much does he love us? He wants to be with us all the time. And that's the way it works. What's really cool is that now he wants to be with us all the time. And when we leave this world, we get to be with him all the time. That's all his plan. If that isn't love, the ocean is dry, right? There's no stars in the sky. And the sparrows can't fly. If that isn't love, then heaven's a myth. There's no feeling, there's that word, like this, if that isn't love. Yeah. I tell you what, can you all feel love? Yeah. You can feel love, you can feel hate, you can feel sadness, you can feel happiness, you can feel all of these things. So listen, don't let some group of people scare you out of feeling God's love. You know, I know I'm on Facebook. I ain't caring about it. I ain't going to start caring about it now. But for years, folks, many Baptist people have been very, and I'm not telling, don't you start running up and down and jumping over stuff. Listen, that's not what I'm talking about. But sometimes we're afraid to be aligned with a group of people that are somewhat charismatic. There is nothing wrong with saying, amen. There's nothing wrong with saying hallelujah. There's nothing wrong with saying praise the Lord. If you can't do it here, you won't do it anywhere else. So, God dwelleth in us. The Bible tells us in Galatians 2:20. I want you to turn there real quick because this is a great verse. I would quote it, but sure as I do, I'll mess it up. It's a great verse. Talking about God dwelling in us. Verse 20 of Galatians chapter 2. Sweet, sweet verse that Paul wrote here. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Usually people who are crucified die, by the way. He says, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. There's God dwelling in you again. He says, in the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Can you say that with all confidence? Is the life you live now in the flesh for the one who loved you and gave himself for you? Or do we still got some of it that we want to keep to ourselves? Okay. So the love of God is the evidence of our relationship. It's the essence of our redemption. Verse 19 also says, we love him because he first loved us. Don't even start this that we started this. Okay, here we go. She's sitting right there. Some of you have heard me say this before. Okay? I'm not going to make her say it. I'm just going to say it, and she can tell you I'm full of baloney if she wants to. She was first interested in me. I don't know why, you know, but she was first interested in me. I still don't get it, but I'm glad she was. I'm glad she was, and I'm glad she was willing to talk to me, and I still remember our first almost kind of sort of date. After seminary class, we went to McDonald's, right, in South Haven. Sat at them little tables, you know, that are about that big. With the, you know the swivel chairs? The swivel chairs? Well, she sat facing the table. I sat facing that way. I don't think I even looked at you twice the whole time we were there, did I? But I remembered she was there. So the essence of our redemption is that he loved us first before we loved him. Finally, the ejection of our restlessness. So what the world are you talking about, preacher? Just follow me and I'll wrap this thing up. If you turn with me to verse 17 in that same chapter, 1 John chapter 4. It says, herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Untold billions will stand before God in fear of what eternity waits, of what awaits for them in eternity. We know the great white throne judgment is going to be a terrible, terrible sight for those who have not trusted Jesus Christ as Savior. But listen, because he loved us, and then we love him by faith. And the moment we put our faith and trust in him, and he took up residence within us, guess what? In the day of judgment, we have boldness. We have boldness because we know that we'll stand before the judgment seat of Christ. And even though things will be set there, the way that we lived in this life, whether it be wood, hay, or stubble, or silver, gold, or precious stones, we get all that. We realize that ultimately when that judgment is over, we still have salvation. We will be with the Lord forever and ever and ever. I'm telling you, first of all, if we love God the way we say we should, or the way we say we do, we should not have a pile of ashes at that judgment. Say, well, at least I put my faith and trust in you. Yeah, that's why you're here. That's why you're going to heaven. But that shows how much you really loved him in your life. You're going to heaven because he showed you how much he loved you. What's left at his feet shows how much we loved him. He first loved us. So we're going to be bold, have some boldness at the judgment. We know that even though we'll face some issues in our life, if we don't get them taken care of, if you're saved, you're going to be standing before an almighty God that loves you and is going to take you to be with him forever and ever. We're going to have confidence before him. It says, because as he is, so are we in this world. We have to face the things. We are tempted every single day. He is tempted in all points when he was here, as we are. He knows what we go through. He knows our weaknesses. He knows the infirmities. He knows all of these things. And he's touched by them. He knows how we deal with them, and he cares. Verse 18 says, there is no fear in love. Now, just so you know, this word fear doesn't mean reverence here. It means terror. Okay? Terror. You said, haven't you ever gotten in trouble with your folks and felt terror? Well, it wasn't because I thought that they were going to do something to me that was going to maim me for the rest of my life. But I knew that I would have to face the consequences. But that was out of the reverence. That fear was reverence because I knew they were going to correct me when I was wrong, whether I thought I was wrong or not. They were still going to correct me. But we see here, God's love brings reverence, not fear, not terror to his children. He says, but perfect love casteth out fear. You remember he said back in the verse 12, it says, God dwelleth in us and his love is perfected in us. That means he's always working his love through us ever since the day we got saved, every single day. He said, perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. I'm here to tell you, folks, there are people out there that believe you can mess up and lose your salvation. And they believe that they have to keep their nose clean, because if they don't, God's going to send them to hell. That is not perfect love. It has torment. Do I believe that God will tan our hinies if we're not living the way we should? You better believe it. I am the possessor of a tanned hiney. And I dare say that all of us are, that know Jesus Christ as our Savior. But he does that because he loves us. How many of you ever remember mom and dad saying, I'm doing this because I love you? And you're like, what? Is that what it is? And then, of course, you find out years later, that's really what it was. There are times in our life that we struggle through some things. And listen, this is me. You can disagree with it if you want, that's fine. This is me. I honestly believe that if God is disciplining us in our life, we don't have to ask why. Which one of us would just randomly take our kids and spank their hind end just for whatever, and they have no clue what it's for? What's the purpose? None. Serves no purpose whatsoever for that child. Folks, sometimes we ask ourselves, is God chastening us? I think if we look deep within ourselves, we can find that answer. Is there something that is keeping us from serving God the way we should? Is there something that God is chastening me about? Well, see, that's how perfect love works, because there's fear in the things that we do wrong. And perfect love casts out fear. You see, we live this life day by day. Even though we don't know what's going to happen the next moment, we know God does. We don't know how exactly our life is going to end, but God does. And we know when it's over, we go to be with him. That is how perfect love works. When it's all said and done, we get to be with him. So today, child of God, are we acting like we get to be with him? Are we acting like he's with us? You know? I remember Marcia telling me her dad told her one time. He says, I think this was his words, I may be wrong, but he says, if you can't do it in a church parking lot, don't. Just don't do it. You know, we think that nobody's watching and that everything will be all right. We'll just have our little thing and we'll move on. But listen, God is always watching. And what are we doing to him when we do those things that we shouldn't do? When we're not living for him like we should? As we prepare for an invitation, I want you to consider something. I heard a preacher say one time, when a child of God sins, he is basically, in essence, standing in God's face with his finger pointing at him and says, you're not real. You ever think about that? You say, well, I don't believe that, preacher. I get it. I don't believe that either. But when we purposely do something that we know that is wrong, that would not bring glory to God, why would we do it in full view of him? So, tonight, the love of God is so much. The love of God is why you and I have an opportunity for a home in heaven. You and I, or the love of God is why you and I experience forgiveness. The love of God is why you and I experience grace and mercy and peace. Tonight, if you're lacking any of those things, the love of God can supply them for you but you have to be willing to take the step. So as we stand together.
Page number 255.